3 bullets in the thigh, the calf, and the shoulder, and had traveled in spite of them more than 4 miles on foot. These people have proved that they too possess revolutionary courage and do not shun a rain of bullets. And when an unarmed multitude, without a precise aim common to them all, are held in check in a shut-off marketplace, whose outlets are guarded by a couple of policemen and dragoons, as happened in 1842, this by no means proves a want of courage. On the contrary, the multitude would have stirred quite as little, if the servants of public eye of the bourgeois order had not been present. Where the working people have a specific end in view, they show courage enough, as, for instance, in the attack upon Burley's Mill, which had later to be protected by artillery. In this connection, a word or two as to the respect for the law in England. True, the law is sacred to the bourgeois, for it is his own composition, enacted with his consent, and for his benefit and protection. He knows that, even if an individual law should injure him, the whole fabric protects his interests, and more than all, the sanctity of the law, the sacredness of order as established by the active will of one part of society, and the passive acceptance of the other, is the strongest support of his social position. Because the English bourgeois finds himself reproduced in his law, as he does in his God, the policeman's truncheon which, in a certain measure, is his own club, has for him a wonderfully soothing power. But for the working man quite otherwise. The working man knows too well, has learned from too oft repeated experience, that the law is a rod which the bourgeois has prepared for him, and when he is not compelled to do so, he never appeals to the law. It is ridiculous to assert that the English working man fears the police, when every week in Manchester policemen are beaten, and last year an attempt was made to storm a station house secured by iron doors and shutters. The power of the police in the turnout of 1842 lay, as I have already said, in the want of a clearly defined object on the part of the working men themselves. Since the working men do not respect the law, but simply submit to its power, when they cannot change it, it is most natural that they should at least propose alterations in it, that they should wish to put a proletarian law in the place of the legal fabric of the bourgeoisie. This proposed law is the people's charter, which in form is purely political, and demands a democratic basis for the House of Commons. Chartism is the compact form of their opposition to the bourgeoisie. In the unions and turnouts, opposition always remained isolated. It was single working men or sections who fought a single bourgeois. If the fight became general, this was scarcely by the intention of the working men, or, when it did happen intentionally, Chartism was at the bottom of it. But in Chartism it is the whole working class which arises against the bourgeoisie, and attacks, first of all, the political power, the legislative rampart with which the bourgeoisie has surrounded itself. Chartism has proceeded from the Democratic Party which arose between 1780 and 1790 with and in the proletariat, gained strength during the French Revolution, and came forth after the peace as the Radical Party. It had its headquarters then in Birmingham and Manchester, and later in London, extorted the Reform Bill from the oligarchs of the old Parliament by a union with the liberal bourgeoisie, and has steadily consolidated itself, since then, as a more and more pronounced working men's party in opposition to the bourgeoisie. In 1835 a committee of the General Working Men's Association of London, with William Lovett at its head, drew up the People's Charter, whose 6 points are as follows: 1. Universal suffrage for every man who is of age, sane and unconvicted of crime. 2. Annual parliaments. 3. Payment of members of parliament, to enable poor men to stand for election. 4. Voting by ballot, to prevent bribery and intimidation by the bourgeoisie. 5. Equal electoral districts to secure equal representation, and 6. Abolition of the even now merely nominal property qualification of £300 in land for candidates, in order to make every voter eligible. These 6 points, which are all limited to the reconstitution of the House of Commons, harmless as they seem, are sufficient to overthrow the whole English constitution, Queen, and Lords included. The so-called monarchical and aristocratic element of the constitution can maintain themselves, only because the bourgeoisie has an interest in the continuance of their sham existence, and more than a sham existence neither possesses today. But as soon as real public opinion in its totality backs the House of Commons, as soon as the House of Commons incorporates the will, not of the bourgeoisie alone, but of the whole nation, it will absorb the whole power so completely, that the last halo must fall from the head of the monarch and the aristocracy. The English working man respects neither lords nor queen. The bourgeois, while in reality allowing them but little influence, yet offers to them personally a sham worship. The English Chartist is politically a republican, though he rarely or never mentions the word, while he sympathizes with the republican parties of all countries and calls himself in preference a democrat. But he is more than a mere republican, his democracy is not simply political. Chartism was from the beginning in 1835 chiefly a movement among the working men, though not yet sharply separated from the bourgeoisie. The radicalism of the workers went hand in hand with the radicalism of the bourgeoisie. The charter was the shibboleth of both. They held their national convention every year in common, seeming to be one party. The lower middle class was just then in a very bellicose and violent state of mind in consequence of the disappointment over the Reform Bill, and of the bad business years of 1837 to 1839, and viewed the boisterous Chartist agitation with a very favorable eye. Of the vehemence of this agitation no one in Germany has any idea. The people were called upon to arm themselves, were frequently urged to revolt. Pikes were got ready, as in the French Revolution, and in 1838, one Steffens, a Methodist parson, said to the assembled working people of Manchester, "You have no need to fear the power of government, the soldiers, bayonets, and cannon that are at the disposal of your oppressors. You have a weapon that is far mightier than all these, a weapon against which bayonets and cannon are powerless, and a child of 10 years can wield it. You have only to take a couple of matches and a bundle of straw dipped in pitch, and I will see what the government and its hundreds of thousands of soldiers will do against this one weapon, if it is used boldly." As early as that year the peculiarly social character of the working men's Chartism manifested itself. The same Steffens said, in a meeting of 200,000 men on Kersallmoor, the Mons Sacer of Manchester, "Chartism, my friends, is no political movement, where the main point is you're getting the ballot. Chartism is an if and for question. The charter means a good house, good food and drink, prosperity, and short working hours." The movements against the New Poor Law, and for the 10 Hours Bill were already in the closest relation to Chartism. In all the meetings of that time the Tory Osler was active, and hundreds of petitions for improvements of the social condition of the workers were circulated along with the National Petition for the People's Charter adopted in Birmingham. In 1839 the agitation continued as vigorously as ever, and when it began to relax somewhat at the end of the year, Bussey, Taylor, and Frost hastened to call forth uprisings simultaneously in the north of England, in Yorkshire, and Wales. Frost's plan being betrayed, he was obliged to open hostilities prematurely. Those in the north heard of the failure of his attempt in time to withdraw. 2 months later, in January, 1840, several so-called spy outbreaks took place in Sheffield and Bradford, in Yorkshire, and the excitement gradually subsided. Meanwhile the bourgeoisie turned its attention to more practical projects, more profitable for itself, namely the Corn Laws. The Anti-Corn Law Association was formed in Manchester, and the consequence was a relaxation of the tie between the radical bourgeoisie and the proletariat. The working men soon perceived that for them the abolition of the Corn Laws could be of little use, while very advantageous to the bourgeoisie, and they could therefore not be won for the project. The crisis of 1842 came on. Agitation was once more as vigorous as in 1839. But this time the rich manufacturing bourgeoisie, which was suffering severely under this particular crisis, took part in it. The Anti-Corn Law League, as it was now called, assumed a decidedly revolutionary tone. Its journals and agitators used undisguisedly revolutionary language, one very good reason for which was the fact that the Conservative Party had been in power since 1841. As the Chartists had previously done, these bourgeois leaders called upon the people to rebel, and the working men who had most to suffer from the crisis were not inactive, as the year's national petition for the charter with its 3.5 million signatures proves. In short, if the two radical parties had been somewhat estranged, they allied themselves once more. At a meeting of Liberals and Chartists held in Manchester, February 15, 1842, a petition urging the repeal of the Corn Laws and the adoption of the Charter was drawn up. The next day it was adopted by both parties. The spring and summer passed amidst violent agitation and increasing distress. The bourgeoisie was determined to carry the repeal of the Corn Laws with the help of the crisis, the want which it entailed, and the general excitement. At this time, The conservatives being in power, the liberal bourgeoisie half abandoned their law-abiding habits. They wished to bring about a revolution with the help of the workers. The working men were to take the chestnuts from the fire, to save the bourgeoisie from burning their own fingers. The old idea